about YouTube.
Now you're live on YouTube.
All right. So, I just took out these girls to take a cool picture real quick. But before anything, I want to announce the winner of the 30K follower contest on Instagram. So, I wrote it down on a little paper because you guys have some weird names and I can't memorize that. Hold on just a second. I always forget to turn that off. Okay. All right. So, drum roll, please. The winner is Feraligator 47, Christina. I saw your profile. Your name is Christina. Christina, if you're watching live, send us a DM, a message. You know, send us a DM on Instagram. Tell us, you know, you're the winner. And, you know, we could get it set up so you could get your free gecko. Really excited that I did this. You know, 30,000 followers. I'm so grateful for that. I will be doing another contest, this time for a red striped gargoyle gecko, but when I get to 35,000 followers. And then at 40,000 followers, I'll do another contest. And maybe when I get to 50,000 followers, I'll do a really, really big, you know, contest. Maybe like five people get free geckos or something. But, all right, I'm not gonna put that away. So, today we're gonna talk about breeding crested geckos. Basically the you know, like that, the basics. Everybody always asks me questions. I answer questions every single day about breeding crested geckos. How big should my female be? How big should my male be? What size enclosure? What should they feed them? All those questions we're gonna answer today. So let's get right to it. First things first, some things that you're gonna need if you are going to breed crested geckos is a scale, a gram scale. You could get one that looks like this, or you could get one that looks like this. Okay, either one works. There's, you know, there's different models obviously, but basically you want it to be measure your geckos in grams. That's how you're gonna know if your female is ready to breed or if she needs a couple extra, you know, months of growing or years, who knows. So a female is probably the most important, getting the female up to size is probably one of the most important aspects of breeding. You want to make sure that your females are at least 45 grams before you breed them. You know, you could also breed them at 40, but, you know, experience has taught me that it's better, you're better off to just wait and wait until they're 45 grams. If there's any questions, you can feel free to ask. But this is mostly going to be breeding show. But yeah, any questions?
What did the person win?
Oh, they won a free gecko.
Huh. Do you breed them?
Have you not been following TikisGeckos? Come on now.
Do you breed them and sell them?
Yes, I do breed them and sell them. Now look, check this out, guys. So I put this, this jar here, and I hit the tear button. That way it doesn't take in consideration the weight of that jar. But I just put her on here so I could weigh her. And as you can see, she weighs 57 grams. Here, I'm going to take this real quick from you. Look at that, 57 grams. That is a perfectly good-sized female to breed, okay? So, you want to make sure your female weighs at least 45 grams. She's 57. She's all A-okay. Your male... The male doesn't have to be, you know, it doesn't have to be 45, it doesn't have to be 40, it could be even 30 grams. You just gotta make sure that the male is going to be able to handle the female. If the female's really aggressive and she's gonna start bullying him, then maybe you wanna get your male a little bit bigger. I see my sister smiling over here. What are they asking?
Someone said I won, so I guess they...
What's her name?
Her name is Carolyn.
No, that's not... Carolyn, you liar. It's Christina, I think. Yeah. Christina, the name is Feraligator. F-E-R-A-L-I-G-A-T-R 47. That's the winner. Christina, you want a free gecko. So message me if you want your free gecko. If you don't want your free gecko, I'd be happy to give it to somebody else. But you're the one who came up. Okay, so you have your female, 45 grams. Your male, you know, let's say 40 grams or 30, up to 30, from 30 to 45 and on, that's a good breeding size. So you have your two pairs, you have your pair, I'm sorry, you're going to pair them up, put them in a cage. You want to give them at least like, let's say if we're talking bins like these, you want to give them like a 56 quart. If you're talking about like one of these exoterra tanks, we're going to give them like at least an 18 by 18 by 18 for a pair. And if you're talking about like the gallon, like in, what's it called, aquariums, we're going to give them like a 20 gallon enclosure. 15, 20 gallon enclosure is going to do them good. So once you have your cage, this is how I basically set mine up. As you can see, there's a lot of random crap in here because, you know, I got to keep it cost efficient, but I use egg crates. The reason for the egg crates is because they do like to climb on these egg crates. They make awesome poop collectors, so when they just poop on this, I can grab this, throw it away, and it makes my job a lot easier. I have a whole bunch of fake plants in here because geckos love fake plants. They like to drink the water droplets when I mist. They also like to hide in between the plants. I have these PVC tubes. What you could also use are the insulation tubes from Home Depot. That's Depot, not Depot. Okay? You can use the insulation tubes from there. And yeah, let me see if I have any laying around here so you guys can see.
Someone asked if you ship to California.
I ship everywhere in the United States and almost everywhere in the world. But it could get expensive. But yes, I ship to California. It's $50 to ship to California. So look, these are insulation tubes that you can find at Home Depot. You could get them. You get like a really long one for like $1 or something. Not much. You could cut it into pieces. This is what I like to do. I jam them in here. And they're pretty sturdy. The geckos are not going to knock that down. And they make great branches. It's cheap. It's the geckos don't really care if it's a wood branch or if it's a, you know, insulation tube. They just want something to climb on. So you could use that. You could use a PVC tubes. Just set up, give them a lot of room, a lot of places to hide, a lot of places to get away from each other if they're stressing each other out. And, you know, you're going to keep them basically like you keep every other gecko. You know, you want to make sure you keep them at room temperature, you know, the perfect temperature. For breeding, I would say it would be like 76, 78 degrees. You want to mist them down. Depends on where you are and what type of enclosure you're housing them in, okay? These enclosures here, like these are not going to require as much misting as, let's say, a 20-gallon enclosure or one of these exoterras because these lose humidity much easier. So you got to take that in consideration. You can't just, you know, mist away. And then the enclosure is going to be wet all the time like it's a freaking frog and your gecko is going to get some sort of problem. And then you're going to blame, you know, who knows, the breeder or whatever.
How much harder to care for a crested versus a leopard gecko?
It's pretty much the same. They're very, very easy. Leopard geckos, you know, you keep it with a heat mat, feed it insects. Crested geckos, no insects. Well, you do feed insects, but not as... That's not their only source of food. And the crested geckos you keep in room temperature. But I don't want to get into too much of that conversation. If you have, you know, I have a whole bunch of YouTube videos that you could check out talking about, you know, crested gecko care and all of that. So, you know, we will get on with this video. All right. So, okay, really important. This is when you have females, you're gonna need a lay box. What I do is I grab old food containers from like, you know, the Cheesecake Factory or whatever. So I'll grab that, I'll make a hole in it, and I'll put some peat moss in there. That way, oh, look at that. Get close. See that right there? When the females are about to lay, you'll see them, they'll go into their lay box, they'll start digging around, they'll get some dirt in their mouth, and they pack the soil just like this. Usually, like, it'll be kind of messy. And you see I got more eggs over here. I probably got four eggs. So I got one here. I'm gonna put this to the side. There's another one here. So, two eggs. Oh.
Do you sell giant geckos?
Yes, but I don't have any at the moment. I don't have any giant geckos for sale at the moment. So, I only found three eggs, meaning that one of the females only laid one egg, which happens sometimes. But, so after you pair up your crested geckos, they should be... It depends on the female. If the female's a virgin, then she's probably going to take a little bit longer to breed, to put the eggs. She's trying to get away. But she ain't getting away. She freeze. Put back in there. Sorry. Alright. So, once you put the male and the female together, let's say they're a breeding, you know, they're proven crested geckos. They've already produced eggs in the past. Usually, in about like a month to 2 months, you'll get your first set of eggs. And then after that, you should get a new pair of eggs every month. Now, some females can lay up to, you know, 10 clutches of eggs. Some females can lay up to, you know, only 3 or 4. So it just really depends on the female. That's another reason why I like to make sure that the female's at least 45 grams before I breed her. So she's not going to have, you know, so she's, you know, so she can withstand the process of egg making, you know. But put the lay box. When you make the lay box, you want to make sure that the soil is moist, but it's not wet. Okay, that could that could do harm to the eggs. That could give them mold. And you also don't want to have the substrate too dry, because then the eggs are going to, you know, they're going to dry out. They're going to indent themselves, and then you might lose them. So once you have the eggs over here, you're going to grab, you're going to put this gecko back. Any questions?
Do you sell toques?
Toque geckos? Yes, I do. Toques. I sell everything. Everything your little heart desires, I sell for you. Okay? Now I'm going to grab one of these. This is one of my incubators, okay? All right, before, I know this video kind of sucks because I'm all over the place, but bear with me. Now, before I show you how to incubate the eggs and all this stuff, really important, this blue liquid, this blue magic liquid is chlorhexidine. If you know, you could usually get this like on, I think you could get it at Walmart if I'm not mistaken, or you could order it online, or if you have a friend or a family member that works at a vet office, they could probably get it for you. So this is the best thing to use to clean cages. This, you can spray this directly on the gecko, it's not going to harm the animal, and it disinfects. So when you're cleaning cages, you know, if there's a little bit of residue of this, you're not going to have to worry. You don't have to be, you know, you don't have to be super picky about completely rinsing the enclosure out. Obviously, you could rinse it out, you know, it's going to be better, but it's not going to harm the animal, and the fumes are not going to harm the animal. So it's like the best, you know, cleaner to use. Disinfects, and you only need, in a big jug, you could put like one part chlorhexidine, 10 part water, and that's going to be, you know, more than enough to disinfect all your gecko enclosures. Now, what you're feeding to your crested geckos is very important when you're breeding them. Obviously, breeding takes a toll on the, you know, on the females and on the males sometimes too. So this is what I recommend. If you're feeding Pangea breeding formula. We sell this stuff. So if you need it, we could sell it to you. When it comes to Rapashi is also a great product. You could feed, you know, the original, the classic. You could feed the mango flavor. You could feed this grubs and fruit, which I really recommend. And this grub pie. The grub pie is basically, it's like a powder you mix with boiling water, and it makes like a gelatin. And then you cool it off, and you wiggle it in front of the gecko's face, and they go crazy for it most of the time. So you want to make sure you're feeding good diets. Don't be feeding any of that PetSmart, you know, crested gecko garbage food. Feed Rapashi or Pangea. Aside from the powder diets, you know, that you're feeding 3 to 4 times a week, you're going to feed crickets. When you feed crickets, it's very important that you dust them with calcium. What I like to use is this Calcium Plus from Repashi. It basically, you know, it gives it all the vitamins, all the nutrients they need. It has D3 in it, so the crickets are going to be coated with all the vitamins that they need to transfer over to your geckos so they can keep laying eggs. Nice pearly white eggs like these over here. See that? Those are good eggs right there. Okay, so feed Repashi, feed Pangea breeding formula, clean with chlorhexidine, you know, humidity 60 to 80%, temperature 76, 78 degrees, put them together, and that's pretty much as easy as it's gonna get. So let's get on with the eggs. So once you have your eggs, here, let me find out where to put this. Let's do this on the floor. Okay, once you have your eggs, okay, you can make, you're gonna candle the eggs. You could put a light under the egg and you could find the little red circle, and then you're gonna put that little red circle facing up, okay? Since we're using the phone for the YouTube live, I'll do that later. But so you put the eggs here, you bury them halfway right here, just like that, and then you just leave them there. Don't touch them, don't try to, don't try to move them around too much. Just leave them there. Make sure the substrate is nice and humid. You want to have a similar humidity in here than you do in the gecko cage. And look over here, we just got a little new hatchling. Look at that. This is a little baby from Ponche Crema, and it's gonna look exactly like that when it gets older. Has some dirt on its head. It's all good. So once you're incubating, here, let me fix it. Instagram's kind of blurry. It's all good. So I'm gonna leave this guy in here for now until I finish the video, then I'll put him back. But once you put the eggs to incubate, you could use Repashi Super Hatch, you could use peat moss, you could use vermiculite, you could use perlite. Most of these things you can find at Home Depot, you can find at your local nursery. What happened?
It wasn't a comment, but you got a message that asked, where is the TikisGeckos shop at?
The TikisGeckos shop is right here, and it's coming soon, somewhere near you, but not yet. So once you incubate the eggs, depending on your temperatures, they should hatch in about 60 to 100 days. Then you'll get nice little baby crested geckos. The perfect temperature, I would say, to incubate the eggs would be around, like, 76 degrees, 76 degrees. That's the perfect temperature because it's not too cold and it's not too hot. If you incubate really, warm, like 78 to 80 degrees, you will hatch babies much quicker, but they're going to be considerably smaller. If you incubate at colder temperatures, like 68 degrees, then you're going to hatch a little bit bigger babies, but your hatch rate isn't going to be as high.
What do you do if the substrate dries?
Okay, that's a good question. So during the period of incubation, the substrate shouldn't dry. That's very important. Maybe I'm not going to get to every single detail in this video, but you can check out my YouTube video of breeding crested and gargoyle geckos, and I go over, everything in more detail in there. But once you make the substrate, let's say you grab the peat moss, you put water in it, then you're going to let it soak in there for a little bit, I would say like 5 minutes. Then you grab all the peat moss, you squeeze all the water out until there's like a couple drops coming out, and then that's how you're going to use it. You don't want it to be wet to put the, you don't want to put the eggs in wet substrate. You want it to be a little damp. That's it. With this super hatch, the reason why I like it is because when it starts to dry out, it's gonna go a different color. I'm gonna show you right now.
Someone also asked, how long do you leave the babies in the incubator when they hatch?
I mean, as soon as you see them, you can take them out, but if you don't take them out right away, it's not a big deal. So check this out. This, by the way, guys, see what that says? Glory, salsa, Hershey, glory. These are lily white eggs. I have 8 so far. These don't look too good, but hopefully they'll make it. But anyways, look, this is why I like the Super Hatch. This is dry, completely dry. And this is exactly how we want it to be. Not too wet, but not dry at all, you know? So when the Super Hatch, when you see that it's starting to go dry, it's gonna turn this color. Now, I don't recommend you adding water. Like, if the eggs were to be here, I wouldn't add water because, you know, the eggs could absorb too much water in one time and it could kill the babies inside. I don't know if that made sense, but just don't add water to the substrate with your eggs, okay? Make sure that before you put the eggs in the incubator, they are, you know, ready to go in like that. That's gonna hold its humidity until all those eggs hatch, no problem. You see, I don't have a whole bunch of holes in this. I only have one up here, and every now and then I open it because I gotta put new eggs, so that's gonna give it enough oxygen. If you have a whole bunch of holes, it's gonna get drier a lot quicker, and you don't want that. You don't need a lot of holes, okay?
How long do the eggs take to hatch?
I said that before, but they take depends on your temperature. It's like 6, could take from like 70 to like 100 days. So it just depends on you and what you incubate at.
Do you ever go to reptile shows?
Oh yeah, all the time, but I'm in South Florida, so I do like the Miami show, I do Fort Lauderdale, I go up to do Tampa, Orlando, those reptile shows. This year, guys, I'm gonna be at Tinley Park and NARBC in Chicago. No, well, it's in Tinley Park, Illinois, which I'm really excited to, you know, go out there. I'm not gonna be vending, I'm not gonna have my geckos for sale. I'm just gonna go hang out with some people and it's gonna be a lot of fun. I'm also planning to go to Daytona here in Florida, up north. And hopefully, you know, maybe I could go to one of those California shows that I hear are really good. But as of right now, I don't have any other California shows planned. Any other questions?
Are gargoyle geckos harder to breed than crested geckos?
No, they're not harder to breed. They just are a little particular. Like, for example, the females don't tend to be as prolific as the crested gecko females. And gargoyles, like, I like to pair up my gargoyles when it's cool, that way they don't fight too much, because if you pair them like in the summer when it's, you know, like 78 degrees, 80 degrees, then they're gonna fight a lot, they're gonna rip each other's tails, and they could be a little bit more aggressive. But you know what I always say is, if you want perfect animals, then don't breed your crested geckos or your any animal for that matter.
Do you prefer Rapashi or Pangea?
Who asked that?
I don't know. They're someone okay. Who sent a direct message, I think.
What do I prefer? Listen, they're both good. I prefer to use both of them, okay? I'll say this though, Rapashi has been around for the longest, and it's what we all have been using. For, you know, it's proven that it's, you know, one of the best products, bar none. But Pangea, the geckos tend to like a little bit better. So that's why I use both. Sometimes I'll even mix them. But I use Rapashi and I also use Pangea.
How can you tell that the substrate is too wet?
Yeah, so like I was saying earlier, if you squeeze the substrate and there's like water pouring out, then it's too wet. You gotta grab it, like compact it and squeeze it. And if there's only like a couple drops, then you know you're that's like the rule of thumb. That's when you know you can use it. What's up? Hit me with your best questions, Instagram and YouTube. Come on.
My gecko will only eat crickets. How do I get them to eat other bugs over time?
Okay, so what kind of gecko is it? If it's a crested gecko, it shouldn't only be eating crickets. It should be eating one of the diets and then insects like once a week or something, or twice a week. But just take, you know, don't give it crickets and put that stuff in its cage. Sometimes you could put, you know, with a little, like, you could just grab some on your finger and put it on their snout, and a lot of times they'll lick it and then they'll get a taste for it, you know. But if it's not eating the diet, then stop feeding it crickets, put some food in there, some of that stuff, and then hopefully it's not going to starve itself to death, so it'll start eating.
My 30-gram crested is laying eggs as former owner kept her with a male as she is small. Is it dangerous?
Yes, it can be dangerous. When females are too small, they could develop problems. They could develop impaction problems. And it takes a big toll out of their body. But, you know, back in the day, we used to think that crested geckos were ready to breed at 30, 35 grams. So, I mean, it's not the worst thing in the world. Just make sure you're supplementing with a lot of, you know, calcium-coated crickets and giving her quality food. You know, that's really important. And, you know, obviously, don't put her with another male. Excuse me.
Are Dubai roaches better feeders than crickets?
Dubia roaches are better feeders than crickets. Now, here in Florida, they're illegal, so I feed discoids. If you're in Florida, you could also feed discoids. They're just a little expensive, but they are better feeder than crickets. Just make sure you gut load all your insects.
What's the best way to transport geckos when moving across the country?
When moving across the country. Okay, so I don't know what the rules are. If you could take a reptile, like a gecko, on a plane. If you can, you could just put it like in a little deli cup like this. You know, these things come in all different sizes with a lid, obviously, and holes. These come in all different sizes, so you could get one of those and put them in there. Or you could get one of those shoebox size containers, kind of like this, and transport them in there. But if they don't allow you to take the gecko on the plane, you're going to have to ship it. So you're going to have to get a family member or friend to receive the gecko on the other end, or to ship it for you when you're already to your new home.
At what age are females able to breed?
It doesn't go by age, guys. I have geckos that are 2 years old that are ready to breed, that are females, and then I have others that are 3 years old and they're not ready to breed yet. So it depends by the weight, you know. Like I said earlier, if a female is, I would say, at least a year and a half to 2 years old, and she's around 45 grams, then she's ready to breed. But if she could be 4 years old, but if she's 30 grams, I would not breed her. Now, you could get geckos to grow at optimal, you know, you could get them to grow at optimal temperature is probably like 78 degrees. You feed every day, you have food available every day, Pangea, Rapache, and then insects once a week, and they will grow, you know, to the best of their abilities, depending on how good of a breeder they are. Yeah.
Someone asked, can you pretty please with a cherry on top show us citrus?
Citrus? Oh, man. I will definitely show you citrus. I haven't shown citrus in a while.
Okay. And someone asked, what substrate do you use for bearded dragons?
For bearded dragons, I use paper, brown paper. Like that up there.
Or newspaper.
Yeah, or newspaper too. You could use newspaper. Wait, citrus.
And someone asked, is it okay to feed mealworms to crusties?
Yeah, it's okay, but crickets and roaches are better feeders. Here is citrus. Oh, snap, citrus. He thought he was falling. This is citrus. Bring over here to more of the mic. This is citrus, guys. He's one of the OGs of Tiki's Geckos. Look at that pattern. He has thrown out some of my best geckos of all time. Look at that face.
But yep, that's citrus.
Okay, a couple more questions and then I gotta go because there's still work to be done.
Can you feed superworms to crusteds?
Yeah, I have in the past, but like people will get so sensitive about that. You gotta be careful with the superworms because they can bite the crested back, but you know, it's not something I would feed like regularly. I could feed it as a treat, you know, but you mainly want to feed like the staple insects, I would say, are crickets or like roaches.
Do you let outside people into your facility to look at geckos? I'm in Miami and I was just wondering.
No, only if I know you personally, then, you know, you could come. But if it's like just some random person, I don't, because obviously I have thousands of dollars in this place. And, you know, so.
Okay, now, a lot of people keep asking who won the giveaway because they didn't hear, so.
Okay, this is the last time I'm going to tell you guys. If you didn't hear it, then you got to go check out the YouTube live video. It'll be uploaded in YouTube in a couple minutes. Okay? The winner, again, is Feralligator. I don't know if I'm saying that right. Feralligator 47. Feralligator 47. And her name is Christina. So that's the winner of the free gecko.
Have you ever had fights between female crusties and breeding groups?
Yes. All the time. Animals fight. Sometimes, you know, they're you know, they don't get along. And usually what I do is I'll, like, separate them. And then I'll try to put them back together, see if they get along. But that can happen. You just got to make sure that they're not hungry. You know, they got to have enough food. They got to have enough space and hiding spots. A big enclosure is no good if it doesn't have, you know, if you're not using the space adequately. You know, you want to have a lot of branches and plants, that way there's a lot of visual barriers and they don't have to be in direct contact with each other. What's up?
I'm about to use my French skills.
Alright.
Quelle est l'espérance de vie d'un gecko à crête? What's the life expectancy of a gecko? I don't know what a crête means.
Did it translate or do you know that?
I know that.
Oh man.
I don't know what a crête means, but.
Okay, the life expectancy of a crested gecko is anywhere from like 10 to 20 years. So they're very long-lived. Same with the gargoyle geckos. Lichianes or giant geckos could be up to 30 years. And yeah, it's pretty impressive, I must say, Nicole.
Thanks. What is the most beautiful gecko you have?
They're all beautiful. 3 more questions, and then we're done.
Show us the white collar chihuahuas, bud.
Alright, I'll show you one. There's actually one right here. I'll show you the best one I have. Okay, one second. Don't mind my butt. Okay, this is one of my white collar chihuahuas. Come here to the light. Check that thing out. Man, that Instagram, it's that Samsung camera. It sucks.
You suck.
You gotta get on that iPhone level. This is one of my...
Pay me better.
This is one of... Alright, you guys didn't hear that. This is one of my most impressive chihuahuas. Wait, go over the top. I feel like the lighting sucks. That's better, I think. Okay. Can you guys see that well?
What are your lowest price for a crested
gecko? We have crested geckos from like $45 to $50. I would say that's probably the lowest priced. This is one of my favorite chihuahuas. He's a male. I got very lucky that he's a male. And he should be maybe like 2 years old now, I think. He's going to be breeding in about a year. And this is going to be his girlfriend. I'm going to show you. His wifey. His forever and ever. His baby is Alright. No more corny jokes. Where is she? She's right here.
Have you tried Big Fat Gecko Smoothie yet?
Yes, I have. I have in the past. My geckos didn't like it too much, but I hear it's very good. This is another...
Someone said, boy, you got some long-ass fingers.
Thanks.
Pencil-looking ass fingers. Fruit by the foot ass fingers.
I'm just kidding, guys. But here, this is the gecko. This is the one that it's going to pair up with that other Chihuahua. Check that lime green out. Nice, right? All right. One more question. I feel like I keep saying that. Like, one more question. Oh, look. You're about to get away. It's $1,000 right there.
How do I feed insects without them going under paper towels?
Oh man, that's a $1 million question. If you find out, please let me know. No, what you could do is you could get like a little bowl, like a little glass bowl. I don't have any around here, but a glass bowl where they're not gonna be able to crawl out. And a lot of times the geckos will see them in the bowl. Like if they're crickets, sometimes they'll jump out but for the most part they'll stay in there. So once the geckos see them, it'll be like a feeding bowl and the crickets will be like trying to get out, but they can't because they're stupid. One more question. Okay. For real though. This is the last one for real.
Can I order Cresteds on your website now?
No, I'm sorry. You can't because currently I'm like working with this guy that we're making my website like more user friendly, and we're gonna make it so it's you could see it on the mobile devices. And there's a couple things that we're still doing, and it's taking me a while because you know I have a billion things to do. But if you want to order a gecko, please message us. You know, we'd be more than happy to help. And you know, that's it. We could help you with that. Message us on email, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat. All the social media, and we will get back to you. Okay, guys, that's it for now. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Christina, message me about your free gecko. I appreciate every single one of you. Thanks for watching, guys, again. And YouTube Live every Saturday at 4 p.m. Eastern Time. And a YouTube Tiki's Geckos episode the last Saturday of every month.
For
I don't want to hear any more questions.
For alligators right there asking, wait, I won. So let's show a little paper.
Yep, that's you. You won.
Congratulations.
All right. Bye, people. Thank you for watching.